your source for everything paranormal. Para-X. The views expressed and the opinions given by the individual host and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Para-X, its affiliates, or its sponsors.
Everybody, and welcome to Stirring the Cauldron here on the Para-X Radio Network. Tonight, we're going to be talking to author Scott Roberts about his book, The Rise and Fall of the Nephilim. Scott is the founder and publisher of Intrepid Magazine, which is a journal dedicated to politics, science, and unexplained phenomena. And he's also a popular public speaker and a stand-up philosopher. Has been interviewed on scores of radio shows and was editor-in-chief of sci-fi Ghost Hunters magazine, Taps Paramag. So now that we know a little bit about the author, let's find out more about the subject, the Nephilim. And as always, if you have any questions or comments for my guest, you can either send me a private message or you can get a hold of Reverend Tim in private chat and offer him a bribe to let you call in. Your choice. And it could be scary because you're dealing with Tim. All right. Hi, Scott. Welcome to the show.
Hi. How you doing, Marla?
I'm doing great. I think I just scared everybody about bribing Tim because you never know what he's going to ask for.
What does Tim take for a bribe?
Well, probably just about anything. This is the scary part. You know, it might be easy, but
Wait a minute, Marla. Hold on a minute. I might be easy, but I'm not cheap. Always remember that.
All right. So, all right. Don't get him, you know, Old Crow. Get him Jameson.
Are you a purist, Tim? I am a single malt Highland Scotch aficionado. So, to me, drinking alcohol is not a tool of, as I've said so many times, it is not a tool of drunken inebriation, but a repast meant for hobnobbing with fellow wizards and brothers in like-minded pedagogy.
It is a sacred ritual that I invoke only with the highest and best.
Amen.
Nice save. Nice save, Tim. Well, so Michael Lauk in chat said that you like kisses. You could be bribed with kisses.
I don't think so. It's got to be better than that.
Said,
it depends on who's doing
who's
the kissing.
Doing it, huh? Exactly. And Swampy said to give you bacon, that you love bacon.
No, that's bacon. Only barbecue pork, but that's a story for another fire. And Scotty will know what that means.
Yeah. Well, and Minnie Horseman says she likes you, Tim, but she ain't kissing you. Sorry.
Wow. Wow. Oh. Is that a statement of singularity of celibacy, or is it a statement of she doesn't think Tim is good looking enough to kiss?
I don't know.
I think it's because my wife is in the chat room, so nobody's taking a chance.
There we go. All right. Well, okay, Tim, you're off the hook. But anybody want to call in? Just give Tim a PM and find a bribe, and now you kind of know what he's after, and you can call in and talk to us. In the meantime, we're going to start talking about the Nephilim. And the subtitle, Scotty, of your book is The Untold Story of Fallen Angels, Giants on the Earth, and Their Extraterrestrial Origins. Now, I looked up the Nephilim, and they were described as a race that came in to dominate in the antediluvian world and were referred to in the Bible as heroes of old, men of renown. Reportedly, the children born to the sons of God by the daughters of men. So the most obvious interpretation that hit my head was that they were a hybrid race between two distinct beings, most commonly believed to be, you know, extraterrestrials and humans. Is that accurate?
I'd say that is a pretty accurate basic description of who they were. Mm-hmm. And I went to the source of the word Nephilim. There's been a lot written about the Nephilim. There's lots of books as far as nonfiction books. There's even a series of fictional books written about the Nephilim. Cuba Gooding Jr. was in a movie not too long ago, a few years ago, about some Nephilim alien frozen in ice. Ooh. And so it's reached that pop cultural level, meaning the word is recognized out there, and it's recognized as having to do with aliens for the most part, and beastly aliens in some contexts. And yet, I went to the book of Genesis to do my research to begin with, because that is the source point of the word Nephilim. It's a Hebrew word, and you find it in the book of Genesis. And when I say it's a source point by meaning it's sourced in the Hebrew Bible. It's sourced in the Hebrew religion. The book of Genesis, the book of Enoch, which was considered to be non-canonical by the councils of Constantine and booted out of the Bible. But it's still an apocryphal book. It's also found in the book of Jubilees and the book of Jasher. And it's also found in the book of Giants, which was part of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which just came uncovered in the last, I think, 10 to 15 years, that particular book itself. Hmm. And so the source point is the Hebrew language. It's a Hebrew word, and it's found in the Hebrew scriptures, or the Hebrew historic / religious writings. And I'll kind of jump the gun on this thought because I hear a lot of people that will poo-poo some of these notions simply because, oh, well, that's found in a book of faith. That's all about faith. Now, that may be so, but in many discussions I've had on this topic, these books of faith, if you will, were no different than the books of history and the books of keeping the annals of a people. And so in ancient times, unlike what we do nowadays, history, religion, spirituality all seemed to mix together. Because they talked about if some warrior king was writing about the annals of his great victories and he was praising the gods for it and this god shall do this and that and so on, these were all books of history that were also books of religion. Mm-hmm. And so never the twain fell apart from each other until actually more recent times in history, if you will. You can even go back excuse me for my cough, as I mentioned off air. My family's getting over the plague here, and I've had this dangling cough for about the last 3 weeks. But you look at the reigns of Henry VIII, the reigns of Queen Elizabeth, all of these things, history was so inextricably linked with religion, Protestantism versus Catholicism, and so on. Mm-hmm. It took on a more direct tone back then than this overwhelming spirituality. But these were the things that drove histories, and right. They drove wars. And this is the same thing with all of this. So when we go back to the book of Genesis and other books of the Bible, apocryphal books that were booted out of the Bible by guys, because they didn't think it belonged there. You've got all these books that find their sources in religious writings that are also historical writings. So I find very little reason to doubt that there is some veracity, at least to some of the things that are talked about historically, even though it's contained in religious context.
Right. Now, you know, one of the things too, because I was kind of listening to you on Coast to Coast as well, and you brought up an interesting point about the duality of the word Nephilim, as in Elohim. It means singular and plural at the same time, does it not?
It does indeed. As a matter of fact, it's a word in the Hebrew. Nephilim is a plural word. There is the im or the him in Hebrew on a word that denotes plurality, and it's usually used as a suffix at the end of the word. So Nephilim, the base word in the Hebrew for Nephilim is Nephal, which means to fall, to come down, to descend, to leave one's estate for another place, that kind of thinking. And it could expand beyond that to other applications. The im suffix put on the end just turned the word into a plurality, meaning those who fell, those who came down, those who left their estate for some other place, and so on. The word Nephilim is very similar in its sound, at least, or at least its application, as the word Elohim. Now, Elohim was one of the many names of God that you find in the Old Testament. And Elohim was the word used for God most times, almost 3,000 times in the pages of Old Testament Hebrew scripture. Mm-hmm. And the word with the im suffix put on the end, it created a plurality. So the word itself, El, was the name for God, E-L. And you actually find that all throughout the Bible in Elohim, El Shaddai, Elyon, you find it in the archangels' names, Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, Azazel. These characters were bequeathed of God. They were messengers of God, or they were sons of God. And so they had that L on the suffix of their names, denoting where they came from. Mm-hmm. So El was the name for God. Ohim, the O is just simply like, almost like you'd say, you know, Matthew O'Brien, you know, he's of the Brian clan. He's O'Brien. He's the son of Brian, you know, right. Things like that. A Brian Boru. There was a great history of the Irish with the O meaning of so and so. And it's really the same, thing that you've got there. You've got El Ohim, and it's meaning of. So it's God of the plurality, or God of many gods, or God among many gods, is what the word actually means in direct translation. So right. You've got a word that is the name for the God of all gods, as mentioned in the Bible 3,000 times, used in the Old Testament, meaning actually a plurality. And the only difference with this word from like Nephilim, Nephilim denotes a strict plurality. Elohim, when it says God of many gods, the oh in there that comes in, this is a word that is denoting that it is a word that could be used as a plural or used as a singular, depending on the context of the passage in which you find it. And so, and I even say in the book, this is exciting stuff, talking about Hebrew etymology, ancient etymology of language. I mean, what other topic can you think of that can gloss somebody's eyes over very quickly? So what you have to do when you're looking at this is say, there's a certain passion. You've got to deliver this with this talk about this and say, look, this means something. If you are Judeo-Christian, this means something to your faith. There's meat behind this. And looking into the etymology of ancient words can tell you something about them. And I use this illustration a lot when I'm speaking, but I say it's like, do you remember Michael Woods? He's a archaeologist, historian, anthropologist. He does series for PBS. He did a series on the search for Troy about 20 years ago, I think, on PBS.
Right, yeah.
I remember watching him on that show, standing on a beach, and the wind is blowing, and the water's kind of spitting at him a little bit, and behind him is this cliff face, and there's a strata of rock in there that you can see all different layers, and he's talking about the strata of rock. One is, you know, shows clay and dirt, and then silt, and then dirt, and then oh my God, there's a layer of burned ash, and then there's clay, and then there's silt and dirt. And you could deliver that message very deadpan and put your audience to sleep. But here's Michael Woods standing on this beach, and he's animated. He's talking about, and look at this. He says, there's this layer of clay, and then there's this layer of dirt, and then look, there's a layer of ash. And this layer of ash denotes that this was burned here. And then there's another layer of silt, and, you know, and he's adding it all up. And to him, he was passionate about stratas of different types of sediment. In a cliff face. And why was that passionate to him? Because it meant something in establishing his case. Same thing with Elohim. This is a word that if you use it singularly, or you can use it singularly or plurally. And it's a lot like our word deer in the English language. It works the same way. I can say, I see a deer, singular, standing in my front yard, or I see a herd of deer, plural, in my back pasture. So it's the same word that's used equally, and it doesn't change in tense. It's the words around it change to change the how you're using the word. So Elohim, God among many gods, God of many gods. And it's not speaking, sorry, Trinitarians, it's not speaking to the Trinity. It's not talking about God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, because those things are not spelled out in scripture. Mm-hmm. And as a matter of fact, this is the Hebrew scripture. This is pre-Messiah. There is messianic prophecy, but they're not talking about God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. That's a Christian thing. That's a New Testament invention, if you will. And I don't use the word invention to step on anybody's religious sensibilities.
Yeah, exactly.
So here were the first big questions I had about scripture, and that actually made me start digging into some of these things, is who is this God among many gods? And I will tell you this, and again, not to offend anybody's religious sensibilities, but I will make this statement. I believe this is true. Judeo-Christianity does not teach monotheism the way you think it does. It may teach that Elohim is the God above many gods, but it never tells you that there are not more than one, that there is not more than one. You have God, even in the Ten Commandments, says, I am the Lord your God, you shall have no other gods before me. That's not just picturesque language. That's him saying, if you are going to follow me, you will not honor these other gods that are here. And it's very obvious that there is a caste of gods, that there is, you can call them gods, demigods, you can call, they're not angels. That he's talking about under these terms. So the Elohim are actually referred to in the plural in the Old Testament. And this will relate to some of what we talk about later in this discussion, but you go to Psalm 82, and it says this, and I'm going to interchange the Hebrew word for the English here. It says, and Elohim stood in the midst of the Elohim. So that's a plural, that's a singular person standing in the midst of a plurality. Mm-hmm. And he said to them, singular saying to plural, you are Elohim, plural, the bright shining princes of heaven. But I could strip your immortality from you and you will die like men. The passage goes on, he's passing judgment on them for something. This relates back to the people who came down and bequeathed the Nephilim with human women. And this is the act of judgment that's being passed on them by the superior God or the supreme God. While he is not referring to them as angels, he is referring to them as gods, as Elohim. And these are the characters that you see when the sons of God came down and intermingled with the daughters of men and had children by them known as the Nephilim.
Right. Now, you mentioned angel a minute ago, and there's a reference to fallen angels. And as I was reading more, the term fallen angels in some circles, especially in regards to this, are considered the extraterrestrials. But a lot of people think of fallen angels as those angels who rebelled against God, sided with Lucifer, an archangel who became a devil. And in fact, one of the articles I read said that the Nephilim had way more knowledge to pass on than they should have, because according to the book of Enoch, God was incensed against the fallen angels, partly because they disclosed classified information to humans. So it all gets a little bit confusing when we're talking about fallen angels, but I guess for all intents and purposes in this case, in regards to the Nephilim, the first definition is the one that applies, correct?
Well, what I see about the Nephilim is this, and let me answer your question in a long way rather than a short way. One thing that you will find is that these stories of these beings, as mentioned in Genesis 6, of non-human entities, or the sons of God, they're called, the Bene Ha Elohim, they're called in the Hebrew, they came down and they intermingled with the daughters of men, or in the Hebrew it says the daughters of Adam, meaning the daughters of man. And there's a stark contrast given in that verse. I've heard theologians explain this away, both Jewish theologians as well as Christian theologians, saying, well, these characters were obviously just the sons of the prophets, humans. They were from the schools of the prophets, and they came down amongst the common folk and took women as wives amongst the commoners. And I said, that's all fine and good. That's a great theory for all you theologians out there who've spent your life studying this language. But let me ask, and I would ask them, why then does it not say that in the passage? Why is there a stark contrast made? There's a contrast by calling them the sons of God versus the daughters of man. The Bene Ha Elohim versus the daughters of, and I don't know I can't pronounce the Hebrew word for daughters, but the daughters of Adam. There is a contrast that has been made. And there's a reason that contrast is there. When things were written in scripture in these ancient texts, there was a reason they said things the way they said them. Now, having said that, there are over 600 different cultures, religious culture, ancient cultures that have religious texts that refer to these kinds of beings interacting with humans. Mm-hmm. And they're all linked to their versions of, get this, the flood story that we find in Noah and the Ark in the Hebrew Bible. Mm-hmm. And the Nephilim appear in Genesis 6, and just a few verses later, it starts the account of Noah and the Ark story. And what was never taught when I was a kid is that these accounts are linked. The Nephilim are actually, that's the preamble to the story of the flood. And you take all of these different cultures that have these stories, all different casts of characters, different events, but the common threads to all of them, where there was some spirit being or non-human entity that came down, interbred with human women, created a race of hybrids, some deity or some superior power got really pissed off by this and cast judgment on the entire planet and carried it out through a watery flood to eliminate this hybrid race. And that's the common thread to the story. And if you take and separate yourself, get out of the box, and look at this all, no matter what your faith is, maybe you are a Christian through and through or a Jew through and through, it doesn't matter. Step outside of the box for a minute and look at it as a whole, and you will see, take a look at it through the filter of religious creation story, flood story mythologies out there, and look at it and say, wait a minute, there's all these stories that exist. Did they just copycat each other, or was the story found in the book of Genesis the only true story? Or do they all hail back to a common event and they've all put their own tag on it? And that's what I think you have here.
Mm-hmm. Now, I've got a question from the chat room, and it kind of goes along with the question that I, or a comment that I was going to bring up. So I'll say what I was going to say, and then I'll throw hers in. Because ancient writings make mention of the Nephilim in all cultures across the board. I mean, the names Goliath and Gilgamesh and Og and, you know, da-da-da-da-da.
Right.
How do you feel about those who consider the Nephilim to be strictly mythological creatures?
You know, I think I would say you might be right. Is how I would say that, because when we really comes down to it, there's no way to prove any of this ever happened. All you can say, the closest thing you have to proof is, and I can say this to Tim and you and anybody else out there who's done paranormal investigation work. How many skeptics and scientists believe that you have evidence that ghosts exist?
Mm-hmm.
That's the answer to this question.
Right.
You can have as much evidence as you want, and you're going to be have people say, well, that's not real evidence. That's anecdotal evidence. Mm-hmm. Show me real evidence. You know, have a ghost do this or that, whatever, blah, 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 down the line. I've had skeptical friends I've talked with about that for years. Yeah. And I say, look, I've had enough experiences that I know. I entered this thing pragmatically when I started 12, 13 years ago doing ghost hunting, investigation work. And I've been talked to, I've been whispered in my ear, I've caught it on tape, film, photographs, I've been pushed, slapped, touched, sworn at. And I have enough anecdotal evidence that for me, I have absolutely no shadow of a doubt that we're communicating with something. Now, is it a ghost? We don't know. We just know that it's something. Mm-hmm. Now, that'll be the next stage. When you prove that there's actually something there to a skeptic, they'll go, well, that's what I was saying all along. You know, you never said, I said I didn't believe there were ghosts. You don't know what it is you're talking to. No, we don't. But the same thing with this whole issue of the Nephilim, whole issue of ancient aliens, which it spills over into, only by virtue of the fact that once you separate, like I said, out of the religious box and look at all the different cultures that talk about it, you say something huge happened to humanity, and so much so, so big, in fact, that every culture has their version of the story. So something happened. There's no shadow of a doubt about that. And the way I quantify this, if you will, is by saying, while I can't call a watcher or a son of God into the laboratory with a human woman and say, hello, is this thing on? Okay, proceed conceiving a child. And now that you're done, let's do that again. And we'll do it as many times as we can until we prove that this exists by the scientific method. While you can't prove this and quantify it by the scientific method, you can say this, that there is a certain scientific methodology put into play by the overabundance of different cultures that tell the same story with common threads. That means something. If you have, 1,000 years from now, if you have 25 different cultures, as little as 25 different cultures have histories of the Holocaust and World War II, somebody in the future, some Iranian might say, well, I don't believe that the Holocaust ever took place. And you can look at the historical record and say, hey, these people all left a record of this. It happened, dude. You can't prove it anymore because it's not present with us anymore, but we can prove it by historical record. Now you multiply that, you know, an exponential amount of times, 600 plus times, to say something happened to humanity in a big way. You've got some proof going on there, and you've got some scientific methodology at play. Mm-hmm. Did I even answer the question, or did I drift way off on some rabbit?
No, you absolutely did. But let me throw you Ceiling Cat's question, because it kind of ties into that. She said there are giant myths in every continent, including North American Indian culture. Did they exist as a culture that were driven underground?
Did the Nephilim exist as a culture driven underground, are you saying?
Yeah. Yes, giants, Nephilim.
As a general rule, I don't think there's any general rule that applies to any of this. I will say this, though, in speaking to the being driven underground, you talk of some of the native cultures that have the Native American cultures that have their versions of this story. Almost every culture does. I happen to personally enjoy the Celtic version because that's my heritage. I'm Scottish and Welsh. And so I've always liked all things Celtic. And then I read about the Tuatha De Danann, the children of the goddess of Danu, the goddess Danu. And they were called the bright. Now, remember when I talked about Psalm 82 and mm-hmm. God talking to the divine council, it's called there. But he referred to them as Elohim, the bright shining one, princes of heaven. Mm-hmm. Relate that to the Tuatha De Danann and many of these other creatures that exist throughout all different cultures' stories. The Tuatha were the bright shining kings who descended from the heavens, and they were tall and elegant, and their skin shone. It said they were bright and shining ones, and they brought forbidden knowledges to humanity. They also interbred with humanity. Well, they became eventually, they were known as the elven folk who receded into the hollow hills, into the earth. And the hollow hills being that mystical phrase that surrounds a lot of the Arthurian legend and the fairy realm. Well, these are the elven folk. And if you think of J.R.R. Tolkien and some of his fictional writing and his depiction of elves, you also look at other things he's written about in his books, the subtext to a lot of things. This is a guy who had his finger on the pulse of things that happened, I believe, in prehistory, the Nephilim being among them. His elven folk are based on the elven folk who came from the bright shining kings of heaven, the Tuatha De Danann. And this bright shining feature is mentioned in other places in the Bible as well. We can talk about this now or later, but I believe the first of the Nephilim happened long before this account of Noah's flood in Genesis 6. I believe it took place during the Garden of Eden story. And you've got the character, the serpent character in the Bible who tempted Eve. And because Eve sinned and ate of the forbidden fruit that the serpent gave her, and she gave to her husband and he ate, that wham, humanity fell. There was a sin nature, according to the Hebrew Bible and Christianity as well, to follow it up. But what you've got here is something very different. You've got a story, a cover story, if you will. And that's not just speculation. That is looking into all the different accounts, again, in all these different religious cultures of creation, first families, and what happened and the fall of those creation families and the trickster characters that are included in all those different accounts. They all hail back to a similar event. Something that happened that is the common thread. And what you've got in this story of Adam and Eve, it's either a factual story told as it happened exactly as it's told in the Bible account, or it's an allegorical tale, or it's a mythological tale. It's a legend that's used to cover as a cover story or a brief explanation as to what really happened there. Let's say, for sake of argument, Adam and Eve were literal two people that were the father and mother of human culture as we know it today. You've got a serpent character. Now, who are we told? I can ask you this. I'm sure you know the answer to this one. This one's easy. Who was the serpent character? Who are we told in Sunday school and church and Jewish religion and synagogue? Who are we told this serpent character is?
The snake.
He's a snake, but who was he?
The devil, of course.
The devil. Yes. Satan, Lucifer. But what's interesting is that you never find those words, those descriptors, those names found anywhere in the passage in the Hebrew. It never calls him Satan, the devil, or Lucifer. That's attributed thousands of years later. Mm-hmm. What you've got in this passage is a character, a serpent character, and he goes by the name in the Hebrew. He's called in the passage Nakosh. And Nakosh, by definition, meant trickster. Bringer of illumination, bringer of knowledge, bright shining one. Now you compare that bright shining one definition of Nakosh, the serpent in the Garden of Eden who tempted Eve, and compare it to the bright shining princes of heaven in Psalm 82, to the bright shining Tuatha De Danann, and all the other cultures that mention these bright shining giants or these bright shining kings or royalty or spirit beings or non-human entities that they encountered, and you've got the same character in the biblical account of Adam and Eve and the fall in the garden. Mm-hmm. And while all the Hebrew verbs and action words and tenses used in that account are all very common words, commonplace words, it says, and Nakosh, he tempted Eve, which actually meant in another usage, seduced Eve. You've got Eve seeing that the fruit looked good and she took of it. She took it. Well, you've got other places in the Hebrew where it says, you know, and Abram took his cloak and put it on his son. Is that anything but just a common term? This is an action verb. Well, she took the fruit. She ate of the fruit. She gave the fruit to Adam. He took it. He ate of it. And all of this is a cover encoded message for what actually took place there. Eve was seduced by Nakash. Nakash had sex with Eve. Eve brought Adam into the mix, and she conceived from both of them twin sons. And this is borne out in, first of all the other ancient religions that have to do with creation, first families. There were always multiple births. There were always, the wife had sexual relations with the trickster character and bore a child or twins or triplets or quadruplets. There was always, or it was the daughter of the first family that was lured in by the trickster and bore multiple children, in multiple births. It bears out in the whole mythological record when you start comparing it all together. Adam and Eve had two sons. They were twins, Cain and Abel. But one was fathered by Nakash and the other was fathered by Adam, which is, by the way, a medical reality. My own twin daughters, we found out after they were born 20 years ago, the doc said, did you know that Bryn, your younger, was conceived probably 10 days to 2 weeks later than Abby? So I didn't know that was possible. Yeah. We always use that on Bryn, you know, as matters. Said, you're lucky your mom and I were sexually active or you wouldn't be here. So anyway, and the audience laughed. But so what you've got here is you've got a sexual encounter in the Garden of Eden, and it created a dual bloodline. There was the bloodline that was pure human and the bloodline that was tainted, just like the Nephilim who the sons of God bequeathed in Genesis chapter 6. I believe these are the same characters. I believe Nakash was one of the sons of God. Nakash and the sons of God were both part of the divine council, the bright shining princes of heaven. This is who they were. And they were the Elohim. They were the minor gods or the demigods, or they were the caste of gods that Elohim, God himself, had some kind of power over or ruled over. And this bears out this whole issue of the dual bloodlines. This is a story that is, you gotta take a step back from the Bible and look at the big picture of what's going on in the Bible. And you start to see how this all fits together into one big, huge event and story throughout Scripture that encompasses almost everything that goes on in the undercurrent of Scripture. You've got these twins, the dual bloodlines. You come now to Noah and the Ark story a couple thousand years later down the line, and you've got these Nephilim that were bequeathed by the sons of God. And we were taught what about the Ark story, the Noah and the Ark story? Well, God was pissed off that man was corrupt and wicked. He's going to destroy them all with a watery judgment, a flood. And he saved the one righteous man and his family, Noah. And then, of course, the animals and all that come into the play. Mm-hmm. And what's interesting, though, is that that's not how it's spelled out in the Hebrew of the text. You've got the preamble to the flood story is the story of the sons of God bequeathing offspring, the Nephilim, with human women. Then it goes in and it talks about how Noah was a righteous man and how God chose him and God was going to destroy man for the wickedness and the sinfulness of mankind. In the Hebrew, it says this, and I'll just give you Nephilim light here, the story light. The story was actually this. You've got God wanting to wipe out the race of Nephilim created by the offspring of human women and the sons of God, or the watchers, the Bene Ha Elohim. And you've got Noah being called in the English version of the Bible called the only righteous man. And it says, and he was pure in all his generations. I never knew what that meant or how that applied until I started studying this out. Flashback to the Garden of Eden really quick. The fall of mankind. God comes down. He's looking for Adam and Eve in the garden. He's like, Adam, where are you? And Adam's like, we're hiding. And God says, well, why are you hiding? He says, because we're naked. And he said, well, who told you you were naked? And Adam proceeds to blame them. Well, the woman you gave me, she gave this fruit. And the woman is like, the snake said this. And God comes down and pissed off and curses them all. Curses the snake, curses mankind and the sinfulness and so on. But also in this passage, you will find the first prophecy of a Messiah, according to the Hebrew tradition, the Hebrew religion. Now, in this passage, now remember, keep in mind, get out of the box for a second. This is the Hebrew version of what happened with these bloodlines, with these Nephilim. You've got God saying to the serpent, and you will bruise his heel, but he will crush your head. This was very poetic language and is understood in all of Judaism, in Jewish scholarship, in Christian scholarship. This is the first prophecy of the Messiah, talking about how the Messiah will be bruised for our iniquities, but he will conquer over evil. That was the idea there, the first messianic prophecy. And you think, why is that there in the Garden of Eden? Because of the fall of man, we were taught. But then you also have God saying about the serpent and the seed, he says, and there will be enmity, constant conflict between the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman, meaning the seed of humankind. So he's saying there's going to be a dual bloodline that will ever be at conflict with each other. Now, that bears out right away with Cain and Abel. Cain is jealous of his brother Abel's sacrifice and murders him. God banishes him from the region of Eden. Now, whether or not you believe these were actual individuals or they were archetypes, whatever you might believe, this is what the account records in the Bible. Then you go all the way down to Noah, and you see that he was called a righteous man, pure in all his generations, when in the Hebrew what it really says is he was the only pure-blooded man left who was pure in all his generations back to Adam, meaning he was going to bequeath the line of the Messiah from his loins because God was going to destroy everyone else, and he chose Noah because he was one of the pure-blooded families left. The Messiah, according to the Hebrew understanding, and you've got that first prophecy of the Messiah all the way back in the fall in the garden, Messiah, another term they put on it was kinsman redeemer. The kinsman redeemer. If you've ever been in a Christian church at the time of Christmas, they talk about, and you know, it's Christmas time, we're celebrating Jesus who came to us, he was one of us. That hails all the way back to the Hebrew theology that the Messiah had to be of pure human blood. He had to be the kinsman redeemer. And why was it important that that was spelled out? Why was it important to show that Noah had a pure bloodline? Because the Messiah had to sprout from human blood, not the mixed blood of the Nephilim and the humans, or the watchers and the humans, which started all the way back with Nakash in the Garden of Eden. So you've got this huge picture being built, this huge case being built. Then, now, you remember the genealogies in the Old Testament where you would read chapter after chapter after chapter. Now, Melchizedek, bore Abram, and Abram had three sons and bore Joshua, and Joshua had another son and lived for 63 years and bore this child and that. And it goes on for ad infinitum.
Yeah, lots of the begats. He begat this, he begat that. Yeah,
a lot of begats. And now you also have, it's very interesting when you get all the way up to King David, they trace King David's lineage all the way back to Adam. And then they also, when it comes to Mary, the mother of Jesus, in New Testament theology, they needed to establish one thing. After King David, the Messiah, the messianic prophecy started to become the prophecy that the Messiah would sprout from the line of David, the king. He would have Davidic claims to the throne. And so his followers had to establish that Mary was of the line of David. So they trace Mary's family all the way back to King David and then trace him again back to Adam. But here's the interesting part in all these genealogies. Noah, David, Mary, the mother of Jesus, they follow through all these genealogies. These genealogies existed for a reason. They weren't just to add boring text to the Bible. They were there to establish that there was a bloodline being followed from the beginning. And when they trace Mary, David, Adam, all the way, or I'm sorry, Noah, all the way back to Adam, they don't trace it traditionally as they do through the firstborn. That was the traditional way to trace the firstborn son in the genealogy. They traced it through the lesser-born, Seth, the secondborn, and Abel, the lesser-born. Why did they do this? Because the firstborn Cain was not of pure human blood. And this was something that was already very well established in Hebrew tradition. He was not of pure human blood. And therefore, they had to establish that the line of the Messiah had to trace through the line of the lesser born all the way up. And so this is that big picture. Now, take a step back from that for a second and say, there is a huge humanity-altering event that took place according to the Hebrew Bible, and it went back as far back as mankind itself from the very get-go. And that's why you have all these sexual prohibitions in the Old Testament, why sex always became a big issue, why women needed to keep their heads covered. Even in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul writes about, and women, keep your heads covered in church. We do this so that women will not tempt the angels. It's very interesting that he brings in non-human beings as something that women could tempt. And this is why that cultural thing, I think this is where the burqa really came from. It came from this whole notion of keeping purity and at the same time not being a temptation to the non-human entities that mankind encountered thousands of years ago. So withdraw yourself from that picture and say every other culture that's out there, over 600 of them have these stories with all these similar threads. And what you see is this. The Hebrew Bible's version is just the Hebrew Bible's version of the story told many, many times over with all these common events. Theirs is housed in the bringing up of the Messiah the line of the Messiah. But all these stories point to one thing. There were dual bloodlines. There was a bloodline that was established. There was a huge event in human history that took place, and it altered the line of human ascendancy ever since that point. And DNA was altered, and there was humanity interrupted.
Okay, so let's go under the assumption that the Nephilim were created as a result of a union between the extraterrestrials and the humans. Now, why do you think there was a necessity for such a union to begin with? I mean, what was the purpose? And what about those trade secrets that they supposedly shared with us back then?
Right. I don't know that there was this big necessity as a going concern. What we do know is there's some explanation given as to why they did what they did. The Genesis account is very remedial. It doesn't tell you much at all. It's almost like the author of Genesis, who I believe was Moses, by the way, make a great case for this in the book of his historical connections and his historical existence. But when he wrote about the Nephilim, he was copying from another source, because the story, the account of the Nephilim, which takes up about four verses, is all written in a very different style than the rest of the book of Genesis, and it has earmarks of having been edited. The book of Enoch existed long before the book of Genesis, and the wording in the book of Enoch is identical to the wording in Genesis, except what Moses tells in four verses, Enoch tells in chapter after chapter after chapter about these beings. Mm-hmm. This is where we get the term the Watchers. He calls the Bene Ha Elohim, the sons of God, he calls them the Watchers. That they came down and they descended to the slopes of Mount Armon, he says, which is Mount Hermon in northern Israel today. The three-peaked mountain that straddles the border between Syria and Lebanon. It sits right smack in the Golan Heights today in northern Israel. This is the mountain where they came down and 200 of them made a pact. And you have this conversation that's going on amongst the leaders of these watchers. And they say to each other, it says, and they lusted after the human women, or they desired them, or they looked on them and found them beautiful, whichever translation you want to take. But it said that a very telling thing, it says they wanted to go into human women and cohabit with them and have sex with them and bequeath offspring. They were drawn to the human, to the women of the human race. Mm-hmm. And you've got their leader, Shemyaza, saying, don't do this. He says, it's my head is going to roll because I am the leader. And they're saying, we don't care what you decide to do. We're going to do this anyway. So either join us or go back and do your own thing. And he ends up joining them. So it says they made this pact to go in amongst human women and to teach them forbidden knowledges, which the book of Enoch tells us. They taught them all sorts of things. They taught them writing. They taught them the signs of the sun, moon, and stars. They taught them cosmology. They taught them, of all things, cosmetics, mirrors, the making of mirrors. I don't know why those things are considered forbidden knowledges, but this is what they taught. And this is the real crime, is they went in not just to have sex, but they went in to teach the things they weren't supposed to teach them. And go back to Eden again for a minute. I believe this is an allegorical tale. I think Adam and Eve were probably real people. But I think what you've got is a tale, because it talks about how when they ate of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is what they did. And you have God all of a sudden talking. And even in the English, it translates this way. He says, they have eaten of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Let us stop them now, lest they eat of the tree of life and become like us, like Elohim. Mm-hmm. And so God goes in and stops it. So what you've got going on here, once again, is something forbidden, that forbidden fruit. And it bears out in the teachings that the watchers did with the human women back then. And I also think there's a very interesting point that needs to be made. And this is where I started tying it in my book over to the ancient alienist theories. Mm-hmm. And I even said, look, I'm not fully subscribed to the ancient alien theory, but there's a lot to it. But here's where I think it coincides. You've got all these cultures saying the same thing. There was a common event. And it was interesting that Enoch talks about the watchers descending to the slopes of Mount Hermon. Now, Mount Hermon sits on the 33rd parallel north of the equator. I don't know if you've heard this before or not. It might be news to you or might not be news to you. Sits on the 33rd parallel north of the equator. Now, interestingly enough, 33, and numerologically speaking, is the number of illumination, of complete attainment of consciousness. And it sits on the 33rd parallel north. If you trace the 33rd parallel north in a straight line all the way around to the exact geo-global opposite spot on the Earth, you know where you end up? You end up at the crash site of Roswell, New Mexico.
Interesting.
Now, all of this being said, I even say in the book, I don't know what that means, but all I know is this, is that they are finding that all these ancient historical religious sites are all connected through a grid, which you'll call the ley lines. They are all, also many of them in South America, are geo-global opposites to things going on, ancient sites in Tibet or in the Far East. You've got straight lines going from ancient sacred sites in the Scandinavian countries, going all the way through to the Oracle of Delphi in Greece, and continuing a straight line all the way down to the Giza Plateau, where the pyramids stand and the Sphinx. You've got all these lines that are interconnecting in a grid around the Earth. So something is to this. Bill Burns from Ancient Aliens told me, I believe that these were ley lines, UFO flight, if you will, and the 33rd parallel was one of those lines. There's a lot of things that have happened along the 33rd parallel. But those two events, separated by thousands of years, dealing both with non-human entities coming to this planet, is not a coincidence.
Mm-hmm. And interesting, and we're running so fast out of time. But it's just kind of interesting in that you talk, you know, the book is called The Rise and the Fall. And there was one part that I was reading about stuff, and it said that the fall kind of happened because giants no longer exist. And some say they're still with us today, but in a different form. And then there's the mention of genetic hybrid to demon connection, as though the Nephilim became corrupt and somehow morphed into demons. And maybe that's what
you're, I don't think they to. Morphed. They didn't morph into demons. Here's what you've got. If you go to the Book of Enoch, you'll find, and I mentioned this in the book succinctly when I'm talking about the paranormal connection, if you will, all this rise in demonology. If I had a nickel for every time somebody came to me and said, I'm a demonologist, and I want to say, yeah, pull this leg and it plays jingle bells. Just because you say you're a demonologist doesn't mean you know a damn thing about what you're talking about. You're latched into the pop cultural aspect of it, so go home and don't quit your day job. But Book of Enoch says this. It says, and the spirits, the ghosts of the Nephilim who died in the great flood, that these Nephilim, their spirits were born, they were born on the earth, and their spirits will remain on the earth, and they will inhabit the earth. And it says, as they wreaked havoc and chaos and wickedness among men while they were living, they will wreak the same havoc and wickedness among men from their spirit form for all of time. So I think many of the demons that we encounter are not so much fallen angels and devils as they are the ghosts of the Nephilim who are still with us.
I like that. And that could be a whole show, but we are so, so out of time. But I really want you to get a chance to tell everybody where they can find out about
sure.
your book and where they can find out about you, more about you.
Okay. Well, you can go to, I run the magazine intrepidmag.com. You just go to intrepidmag.com. That's our magazine. My link to my book, you can find the book there. That's just got a link to amazon.com, but I'm published by New Page Books. You can find it there. If you want to buy the book, you can certainly go and click on an Amazon link over on my site. You'll just see the link there. I also want to bring your attention to, if you're interested in these kinds of things, the paranormal as it links into these theological things, as it links into ancient aliens and UFOs. I'm putting on a big conference with my magazine in October of this year. You may have seen it mentioned on some of the social networks, but the Paradigm Symposium. We have Eric von Daniken is one of our key speakers. He wrote the book Chariots
nice.
Of the Gods.
Yes.
He will be here. His first American appearance in almost 10 years. We've got George Norrie from Coast to Coast. We have Bill Burns, Philip Coppens, Giorgio Tsoukalos, from the show Ancient Aliens from the History Channel, now H2. Ian Punnett from the weekend Coast to Coast. We've got several authors. Many of you may recognize Laird Scranton, Marie D. Jones, Larry Flaxman, Nick Redfern will be there. And we've got 15, 16 speakers, I think it is. Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report is my partner in this effort, and also now a new partner in Intrepid Magazine. So if you're interested at all, in coming to a symposium that speaks about all of these things, is going to be in Minneapolis, October 18th through the 21st. You can click on the Paradigm Symposium link over at intrepidmag.com. You can't miss it. Or just go to paradigmsymposium.com. Paradigm is P-A-R-A-D-I-G-M symposium.com. And there's tickets on sale now, and I'll tell you what, they're moving already. So it's 7 months out from this event. But if you're interested, I would highly recommend getting over there and taking a look.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for joining me. We just scratched the surface, but we'll have you back and we'll pick up where we left off, because there's some interesting questions in the chat room that are popping around. But stay on the line and we'll thank you properly in a minute. But I want to also thank everybody for listening in, and please join me next week when my guest is author Jason Miller, and we're going to be talking about financial sorcery, something I think we all need to learn more about. And don't forget that this podcast and all the other Stirring the Cauldron shows can be found at Pair X On Demand at www.pair-x.com, along with the lots of great other Pair X shows. So until next time, everybody, blessed be and merry meet again. Good night.
This has been another edition of Stirring the Cauldron with Marla Brooks. Be sure to tune in next week at the same time for another great guest and more fun. Any rebroadcast or other use of this program without permission is strictly prohibited. Copyright 2009.
You have been listening to the Para-X Radio Network.